All right, I am calling the meeting back to order. It is now 10:40. Yesterday, we referred two matters to committee. We are going to take the report of the nitpicking and fly-specking committee that was an open meeting first. Actually, we do need Mr. Eastlake since he's giving the report. You didn't realize he was missing. All right, Mr. Illingworth, would you like to give the report of the committee since you're...
Since I actually wrote it, yes. Yeah, we had a quick meeting after the business meeting yesterday and looked at the questions and felt that the most reasonable solutions were either to pass a greater amendment, thus making it an item newly passed at this convention, or to add the pair of sunset-sunrise clauses. And I have specified what form they should have, if anybody was to wish to do one this year.
Are there any questions for the committee? I think I'd like to have a resolution of the sense of the business meeting that sunrise, sunset is the preferred way to go about delaying ratification. Is there any objection to that resolution? Mr. Yallo.
I believe that while this mechanism could clearly work, I believe that it is premature to make any such ruling until such time as it is actually tried.
Mm-hmm. Got it, man.
Verizon Wireless.
All right, I guess the head to...
Premature to vote on it?
Yeah, I think Mr. Yallo would just like us not to have a resolution. Do we need to vote on it?
Yeah, to adopt it.
We can still call
the question.
Does
not have to listen to Ben.
That is true. All right. So all the is there any other objections or debate on the resolution?
I have a question on the resolution.
Yes, Mr. Blog.
Just out of curiosity, you know, I've always heard we've always done sunset clauses in the past, so I know it exists. Is sunrise clause? Does that actually exist? Or are we actually making this up for the first time?
I believe, and I could be wrong, this was used when the zones went away, but nope, I'm wrong.
Nope, we just put that straight in. There were conditionality about which bidders could still bid because they'd been in the zones. So having delay provisions and exceptions is perfectly normal, but I think this is the first time I've actually done a sunrise clause.
Mr. Kowalczyk.
Point of parlor inquiry, has there been a motion and has there been a second?
No, there was not. That's correct, sorry.
Second.
Oh, that will do it.
Mr. Stanley, for what purpose does the...
I'm doing errand running.
Oh. Ms. Dr. Adams, for what purpose does the member rise? I believe the motion was made...
To do what?
There was a motion to have a resolution that it is the sense of the business meeting that sunrise, sunset is the proper way to go about delaying ratification. I believe it was seconded.
Yep.
I heard that. All right. Since there wasn't, we're now gonna. If there's no one else wishing to speak, we're gonna vote up Mr. Bloom.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to point out that resolutions are not binding on future business meetings or future business meeting chairs. They are merely advice. So people should take that into account while they're voting.
Mr. Kowalczyk.
Wait a minute, let me catch up.
Yep.
Jared, remind them to introduce themselves.
My apologies, I was not here yesterday because of stuff. Is this in regards to a specific, this is, I guess, a point of inquiry addressed at the chair. Is this in regard to a specific motion, or is this a general thing going forward?
This is a general thing going forward, but as Mr. Bloom points out, it's not binding. So if there is a specific piece of business that comes up, whatever that mover wants to do, as long as it's within Robert's rules, they can do. Is there any other points of questions or debate? All right, then I'm going to put the question to the floor. All those in favor of the resolution to... Yes, I'm getting there. That sunrise sunset is the preferred way of going about delaying ratification of a constitutional amendment pending ratification. Please raise your hands. All right, all those opposed? The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The resolution is adopted. We're now going to take up the other...
Quick point of order from the Sergeant at Arms. If everybody could please silence cell phones and other devices that make noise. Thank you.
And
further point of order from the Sergeant at Arms. Would you remind the members to please introduce themselves when they speak?
Yes, just because I know who you are doesn't mean everybody else does. So I may call on you by name, but please don't take that as a, you don't have to introduce yourselves. We're now going to take the report of the other committee to which we referred a matter yesterday, the Committee on Nominee Diversity. There is 8 minutes, I believe, 8 minutes, yes, yeah, of debate, and this report will come out of that debate.
Andrew Adams, I was the chair since I was the one who raised it. You point out the problem, you attempt to fix the problem. The intent...
The number?
Andrew, yeah.
The point I raised was that the motion as passed last year did not appear to meet the intent of the makers of the motion, which was that should a finalist, should there be multiple finalists from the same creator, that it will be the creator who has first opportunity to decide which of those works should appear on the final ballot. They could, of course, leave that up to the will of the voters by saying, just take the one with the highest number of nominations. But we discussed this, and the intent of the committee was to propose amendments to the motion which would not constitute a greater change, which would therefore allow ratification this year, but would better reflect the intent of the makers of the original motion.
My apologies. When I pasted this into the slide, the markup went away, so I'm restoring the cross out and underlining. Hold on a sec.
Okay. We'll take a moment to allow the parliamentarian to present the results of the committee. The committee was unanimous that this achieved the purpose for which the committee was set up, and that the committee believed that this constitutes a letter change, although of course it is the chair's ruling that will decide whether that is the case.
Yeah, and the file I was given it in doesn't have the markup either, so I need to go back to an earlier version.
Talk into the microphone.
I said the file I was given did not have the markup, so I have to go back to an even earlier version. Be eligible to...
Yeah, but it doesn't have... To. Yes, you do okay. Have printout copies of it.
No, you do?
Yeah,
no, on the back.
It's on the back of the other one.
Upside down.
Just tilt your head like this.
Rick, can I get a copy, please?
Yes, the printed version does have the correct markup.
Sure, could you distribute those?
Okay.
I have one.
And at this point, the slide has the markup also, so.
Do I need to read the motion? Would that help? So it's moved to amend the copy of 3.8 point X in the agenda with, if there are more than two works in the same category that are episodes of the same dramatic presentation series, or that are written works that have an author for single author works, or two or more authors for co-authored works in common, only the two works in each category that have the most nominations shall appear on the final ballot. The addition being, the Worldcon committee shall make best efforts to notify those who would have been finalists in the absence of this subsection to provide them an opportunity to withdraw. For the purposes of this exclusion, works withdrawn shall be ignored. That's how it reads if it were to go in right now.
And a brief final explanation before I finish the remarks from the committee. The strikeout on the last line of this, by their authors, author or authors under section 3.2.5, we added for clarity, since there are other sections under which works may be withdrawn, and it was felt that was just a tidying up that would have probably been suggested by the nitpicking and flyspecking committee had we left that in anyway.
Miss Olson, question for the committee. Go ahead.
My name is Priscilla Olson, and the question is, because I'm not sure I understand this, is that if somebody after the nominations has four works in the category, you get in touch with that person decides if they want to toss out any of the works before you decide which to go on to the ballot.
That is correct, and that was that we checked, since Mr. Eastlake was the maker of the original motion, we checked that was the intent of the makers of the original motion, that should be the case, and so that is what we provided the amendment to do, and we believe it is a lesser change because it is effectively the current practice that those who appear on the initial list of finalists are given the opportunity to withdraw any works.
Thank you.
Parliamentary inquiry.
Yes, Mr. Buff.
Does the chair rule that this is in fact a lesser change?
How did I know that question was coming? It is the chair's opinion that given that any potential Hugo finalist, if their work were to appear on the final ballot, is given the opportunity to withdraw that work or any number of works that person or persons is going to be nominated for, that this brings the amendment more in line with current practice and therefore is in fact a lesser change. Ms. Secor, for what purpose does the member rise? So Ms. Secor has appealed the ruling of the chair. Mr. Buff has seconded along with other people. All right, I guess I get to make an opening statement and then you guys can debate it.
Pardon me, point of personal privilege, Mr. Chair, may I return to my seat?
Yes.
I'm not sure if this...
Yes. Mr. Stanley.
Mr. Chairman, in as much as this is a good point, Kevin Stanley, I was trying not to overdrive the mic. Mr. Chairman, in as much as this is the first appeal we have handled at this series of meetings, and I'd like to suggest that the chair review the procedure for dealing with an appeal because I know it's different than everything else we do. Thank you.
Good, you do that while I do this. So.
Yeah, I have.
So it's mostly just that people can only speak once, except the chair who gets to speak
right.
Last.
Yeah.
And then the motion is who is in favor of sustaining the chair.
Right, yeah.
Who's against?
All right. So this is how an appeal works. I, as the chair, get to give an opening statement. Everyone else can speak either in favor or against my ruling, but you only get to speak once. I get to speak at the end, if I so choose, and give a closing argument. So I get to speak twice. We will then put the question to the floor in the form of, shall the ruling of the chair be sustained? That means that if you vote aye, you are saying that the chair's ruling is correct. If you vote no, you are voting against the ruling of the chair. Does everybody understand that? It's a majority vote. Mr. Blogg.
How much time for debate?
Is there a time limit on this?
Out of the 8 minutes.
It comes out of the 8 minutes for the underlying motion. So I would ask the timekeeper to tell us how much time we have left.
1 minute, 15 seconds for the four, and 3 minutes and 15 seconds for against.
Mr. Matthews.
Wynton Matthews, could you clarify whether or not your particular ruling would mean that we could vote now, or if it means that we have to wait another year? Which way does it go? Thank you.
If my ruling is sustained, the motion could be ratified this year. If the business meeting believes that this is a greater change, that would mean that if the motion is voted up after the debate on the ruling, then that would be first passage, and this would go on to Worldcon 75 for ratification.
Well, I need to pass the amendment first.
For what purpose does the member rise?
I wish to move the additional time we added to the debate.
So, how much time would you like to extend debate by? Is there a second?
Second.
Undebatable.
Is there any objection? All right, so this requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of extending debate by 4 minutes, evenly divided, raise your hands. Hands down. All those opposed? I'm going to say that's two-thirds, and the ayes appear to have it, and they do have it. Debate is extended by 4 minutes, evenly divided. Ms. Secor, for what purpose does the member rise? Please come to the microphone.
Just to double check, I'm Kate Secor. It's my understanding that if we pass the amendment and it is ruled to be a greater change, then the amended resolution would have to be re-ratified. If we don't pass the amendment, then we go back to voting on the original form, which would then be ratified in this meeting and take effect next year.
Right. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Did everybody understand that?
No.
All right, so there are three things going on here. There is the chair's ruling, which is whether or not this is a lesser change. If it is decided to be a greater change, and then the business meeting passes the amendment that the committee has reported out, if the motion underneath of that is passed, that constitutes first passage. If it's a lesser change, it really doesn't matter if we pass the amendment, because either way, it's ratified. It changes the wording, but it doesn't change either first passage or ratification. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay. Yes, for what purpose does the member rise?
And if the change is not sustained, I think we're in support.
Point of information, or possibly...
Please state your name.
Ingvar Mattsson. The chair said that if the amendment is passed as a lesser change, the underlying resolution is ratified.
You would have to pass the underlying motion. It's chair's ruling, amendment, which is why we have a chair's ruling, and then the underlying motion.
Thank you.
Three votes. Does everybody understand?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Kowalczyk, for what purpose does the member rise?
We haven't even started the timing yet.
I am doing this to try to speed up the meeting. Would a motion at this time to suspend the rules or whatever and instruct the sergeant at arms in certain cases to walk the microphone to people who wish to speak be in order? Or does it have to wait until there's nothing else on the floor?
It would be a question for the...
It's a handicap issue.
Yeah, it...
I understand that. Can I make my motion and then you can rule whether or not it's in order?
Is there a second?
Well, I have to make the motion. My motion is that since the sergeant at arms is in better health than most of the members of the meeting, it would actually be faster. And while I understand that the video is important, the video should not be driving this meeting, the microphone would still be on the audio recording, that the sergeant at arms be informed. This is part of the motion. I'm making part of the motion and should be entered as text as part of the motion. That the sergeant at arms be informed that to whenever possible, when it is clear who the next speaker would be, because it is a part of parliamentary inquiry or some other business where the chair may recognize them, that the sergeant at arms walk the microphone to the person to speed up the meeting.
I understand the access concerns. However, I think the point of privilege is in order. The meeting can debate the motion or can vote the motion down, but it's in order. So is there a second?
Move to call the question.
I don't need to. Yes, this is not debatable. So all those in favor of having the sergeant at arms, when it is evident, running the mics, please raise your hands. All right, hands down. All those opposed?
Fails.
I'm gonna say the motion fails. All right, so now.
I've made up a slide with the parliamentary situation. Looks like this.
Okay, so I am gonna give my opening statement now. This amendment brings the process for handling this subsection in line with current practice of the Hugo administrators, which is to contact the nominee and ask if, and tell them this work has been nominated, would you like to withdraw it? If a nominee has more than one work, they could very well withdraw all of them, or some of them, or none of them. Not telling someone they have a nomination possibility would then make it farther away from current practice. So telling them that all of these works are potentially nominated, that brings it in line with, or more in line with current practice. Is there anyone wishing to speak against Mr. Yallo? Ms. Secor, since you appealed the ruling.
Hello, everybody. I'm Kate Secor. While I agree with the chair that current practice is to contact people and ask them if they want to be on the ballot, it's a straight up and down. It's your thing got nominated. Do you want to be on the ballot? It is my understanding, and I might be wrong here, that the provisions of this particular amendment are not, do you want your thing on the ballot? It's, oh, you had four things nominated. Which two do you want to be on the ballot? We do not currently allow nominees to choose which thing they want to be on the ballot. It's a straight yes or no. Do you want it or don't you? So I think that changing it such that people, sorry guys, I need to breathe. Changing it such that people can then choose which of their works appears on the ballot from a subsection of three or four or five is a significantly greater change to current practice and to how the Hugos are currently administered.
Mr. or Dr. Adams as the maker of the underlying amendment.
Andrew Adams still. I disagree with Ms. Secor on this. The current practice is that if you have four works appearing in a category, that you get to choose which of those should appear on the final ballot. You can choose, currently you can choose 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. Under the new rules, the original amendments would make that you automatically get two of those four, and you don't get to know about the other two until and unless you withdraw one of those two. And the amendment we have proposed to the underlying motion brings us back to the point where it is the finalist themselves who gets to choose which of those. That is clearly the current practice. You get to choose 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4.
Is there, Mr. Kernigal, a speech against the chair's ruling?
Joshua Krungold. While I agree that Ms. Secor's argument is incorrect, because the instructions in the amendment would put things in line with current practice and are therefore completely unnecessary. Nevertheless, what they're doing is codifying our custom into law. Codifying custom into law is not a lesser change. A lesser change reduces the scope of an amendment. It does not. If we were to pass an amendment, or rather to the Constitution, to codify custom into law, that would do something. A lesser change reduces the amount something does. This does not do this. It adds something new.
Is there any, Mr. Breitbart, a speech in favor of the ruling?
I'll start with an example. Somebody, let's call Seth Breitbart, somebody, let's call him Mike, has four short stories that are potential finalists. Today, the administrator calls him and says, hey, Mike, these four stories can be finalists. Do you want to withdraw any of them? And Mike says, for each one, leave it, withdraw it, however he likes. According to this amendment, that is exactly what will happen if the amendment passes and the motion is ratified. The administrator will call the person and say, you have these four, one by one, should they be kept or withdrawn?
Mr. Yao, a speech against? Well, if you're not sure.
That's because I'm going to need a clarification. Ben Yao. I believe that under current practice, as stated, that we would tell the person you have, for example, two works on the ballot. We do not tell the person, oh, by the way, if you withdraw one of these works, another one of your works gets on the ballot. That what would be the, is it the ruling of the chair that the amendment as stated would say that we do not tell the person that, oh, by the way, if you withdraw one of your works, another one of your works pops up.
It's nothing in the bylaws about it.
Can I? I'm going to ask the parliamentarian, since he's the maker of the original motion, to answer that question.
Let me just point out a few things. Currently, 3.9.1 in the Constitution requires all finalists to be contacted and then determined if they want to withdraw. So contacting the finalists is a well-known thing. The situation facing the administrators is, in fact, dynamic. If somebody has one or four, doesn't matter, on the list, and they if they withdraw some, then other people may move on to the finalist list, other works.
Yeah. Correct, but
and it could be a work by the same author.
But we do not notify, under current practice, we do not notify somebody that if you withdraw one of your works, another one of your works would appear on the ballot.
Sure we do, because once it appears on the ballot, it's a finalist, and they have to be asked whether they want to withdraw it or not.
Right, but we do not notify them.
Oh, we don't notify them in advance of their decision.
In
that
advance
is correct.
Of their decision.
Yes, and this would not change that.
This does not change that, so therefore we do not notify them that if they have two works that are on the ballot, or three works that are on the ballot, and if they withdraw one, or if they withdraw one or two, that others of their choices pop on. We do not notify them of that. Correct. And yes. I'd like a ruling from the chair on that.
That is current practice, is if another one pops up, we don't tell them, oh, you also have the sixth one. If you withdraw one, you have more on the top five.
Great.
Until they withdraw one, and then...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. McCarty, for what purpose does the member rise?
I believe it's time for speech for the chair.
Yes.
Other people have addressed other objections I might have said to the people speaking against the chair's ruling. I will simply say this. It is frequently not the thing that gets the most nominations that wins the Hugo. I would rather the rules not pick that. I would prefer that the creators of the works choose what they think are their best up to two chances to win the Hugo.
Is there anyone?
That was a speech in favor of the underlying motion. Yeah.
Is there any objection to calling the question on the chair's who still wishes to speak on the chair's ruling? All right. There are three people wishing to still speak. Call.
Chairman,
yes.
I would ask the maker, if I may, I would like, before you finish stating that the motion you just made.
Mr. Chairman, Kevin Stanley, I would like to ask the maker of the motion to close debate if he would be prepared to withdraw the motion a moment to give the chairman 30 seconds to make a closing statement.
It's all you have left in closing.
Mr. Chairman, yes, it's withdrawn, yes? Okay.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I move to limit all debate remaining on the appeal to 30 seconds for a closing statement by the chair, and I ask unanimous consent for this motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there an objection? There's an objection.
Well, you got to take the vote.
Yes, I understand that I have to take the vote. All right. All those in favor of closing debate, and other than 30 seconds for me to speak, please raise your hand. All right. Hands down.
It's easily 2/3.
All those opposed? All right, the motion appears to pass. It does pass. I'm going to give less than 30 seconds. I think this comes back in line with the current practice by Hugo administrators. Therefore, I think it's a lesser change. That's it. All right, we will now vote on the chair's ruling. Again, this is a majority vote in the form of should the ruling of the chair be sustained. That means if you vote in favor, you are voting in favor of the chair's ruling, that it was a lesser change. If you are voting against the ruling, then you believe it is a greater change. All those in favor of the chair's ruling being sustained, please raise your hands. All right, hands down. All those opposed? The ayes appear to have it. The chair's ruling is sustained. I'm going to ask the timekeeper how much time is left, if any, on the underlying amendment and the motion underneath of that.
15 seconds for, 3 minutes, 30 seconds against.
Ms. Neal, for what purpose does the member rise?
I'd like to make a motion to extend debate.
By how much? 4 minutes equally divided? There is a motion. Thank you. Is there any objection to it? All right. All those, what?
Parliamentary inquiry. Is this extending time on the-
Everything. It all comes out of the same bucket. All those in favor of extending debate by 4 minutes equally divided, please raise your hands. All those opposed? All right. The noes appear to have it. The motion fails. Can I put the, is there an objection to putting the question on the under, on the amendment? Seeing no objection, we are going to vote on the committee's amendment. That is the strike through and addition that is on the one page handout on the back, wrong side up, that you have. Does everybody understand what we are voting on? Mr. Kowalczyk.
As the person who printed it, I was trying to save paper, and I really don't like the implication I made a mistake.
The chair withdraws his comments on the paper. Does everybody understand what we're voting on?
Yep.
I didn't make an objection. I didn't realize it's over. Can I make a brief objection?
What are you objecting to? The meeting has agreed.
No.
There's still 15 seconds.
On the amendment.
Yeah.
On all of it.
Yeah. Come to the microphone.
Jason Spitzer, I thought we had 3 minutes for and 15 seconds or something. I'm a little confused by this. We keep talking about common practice, and maybe it's me, but the wording to me says only the nominees with the most nominations, or only it works with the most nominations, I'm sorry, will appear on the final ballot. I know we've been going back and forth about whether we contact authors or creators, and we've been going back and forth about whether we contact them and say, you have four things, which two do you want, or you have these two things. So one I'd ask could we clarify that? I know we kind of did or tried to. I'm just confused. Sorry. On the other hand, and I hate to send this back to committee, but should we reword this so that, yes, I know no one wants it, but it doesn't seem clear based on who gets contacted about what when.
So some of these questions are details of administration. The Constitution explicitly leaves that to the administrators of the Constitution. And it's if you can't figure it out, it's up to the administrators to decide, and it can be inconsistent from year to year, and that's the way it is.
For what purpose does the member rise? Come to the microphone.
My name's Rich Horton. I had one very simple question. I'm sorry if it's already been addressed.
Can you lean into, or just, yeah, thank you.
I had one very simple question. I'm sorry if it's already been addressed and I missed it while I was off at a panel. I don't understand what happens if there are two nominations tied. What the amendment or the statement says nothing about if the author has three stories nominated, and all three have the same number of nominations. How do you decide which one, which two go forward?
I'm going to let the parliamentarian answer that question.
Consider I just repeated what I just said. If you can't, if it doesn't say and you can't figure it out, it's whatever the Hugo administrators decide to do. It's delegated to them.
Does it say all tied nominees shall be listed?
Hmm?
Yeah. 393?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
All tied nominees get listed.
So in that case, there would be three.
Probably, yeah. Same way we sometimes wind up with seven these days.
But in that case, does that mean they would be considered as two and you add one extra one? Up the administrator. Okay.
If you can't figure it out, it's up to the administrator. It's very simple.
All right. I'd like to put the question to the floor. Is there any objection to voting on the amendment reported out by the committee? Seeing none, we're going to vote on the amendment. Does everybody understand what we are voting on?
Yes.
All right. All those in favor of the amendment, please raise your hands. Hands down. All those opposed? The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion or the amendment passes. Don't want to. We're now back to the underlying motion. How much time is left?
15 seconds for, 3:30 against.
I'd like to put the Mr. Kowalczyk. For what purpose does the member rise?
Actually, I'm actually
I have an access issue, and actually having the microphone walk to me would have been better. And thank you for embarrassing me. I believe that Mr. Illingsworth made a comment when he was originally proposing this, which I think bears clarification. I'd like the chair to rule on it. I believe I heard him say, perhaps it was someone else, I'm sorry, this has all gotten very confusing, that the author or the responsible person would be contacted and they would be allowed to pick the ones with the most nominating votes. I see nothing in it. Let me finish, please. I see nothing in this that says that the author or the responsible party will be told which gets the most votes. I'd like clarification of that, please.
It would have been Don who spoke.
Yeah, I believe that you're... Do you want to answer the question, Mr. Reese?
Sure. I mean, no, there's nothing in there. I don't believe I said, and I don't recall anybody else saying that the information as to the number of nominations any particular work got would be revealed until it's publicly released, you know, after the voting and everything. So certainly when people who have works on the finalist list are contacted, they're just told, you have works on the finalist list. They're not told what the relative order of them is, of the number of nominations. So.
Yes, Mr. Adams.
And this list would not change that.
Andrew Adams, this point actually came up in the committee discussions yesterday, so I feel it's useful to mention this. It is true that the finalist would not be given the information, but the finalist is at liberty to say to the administrator, please just pick the two with the most nominations. And that fits with that. The finalist can say that, and it is there. They don't have that information, but the administrator does, and they can then communicate that intent to the administrator.
If I could point out that the finalist saying pick the two with the highest nominations is exactly equivalent to the finalist saying I do not wish to withdraw any of my works.
I'd like to put the question, Mr. Is there any objection to voting on the underlying motion?
No.
Mr. Yallo, for what purpose does the member rise? Sorry, I'm...
Sorry, Ben Yallo. Since I do not believe we have had debate on the underlying, I don't believe we can call for debate to be closed until we have at least some speeches in favor and against.
The custom of the business meeting has been.
Mr. Stanley.
Mr. Chairman, I move to erase all existing debate times clocks left on this motion and create a time limit of not more than 1 minute in favor and 1 minute against to be limited to one person per side.
Second.
Is there any objection to that motion? There is an objection. Therefore, we will vote on the motion. All those in favor of removing all current debate time and adding 1 minute per side. All right, all those opposed, please raise your hands. The motion is carried. We have 1 minute of debate for and 1 minute of debate against. Mr. Eastlake, as the maker of the original motion, you have...
1 minute.
Yes.
1 minute. Hi. This is a great constitutional amendment. It does wonderful things. It gives the voters greater choice of different varieties of dramatic presentation series and different sets of authors to vote on. And it's now been improved, and you know, new and improved version has been voted in, and boy golly, everybody should vote in favor of it.
Speech against? You have 1 minute.
Name?
Hyman Rosen. Hyman Rosen. We are debating at the business meetings several other means by which to control what gets nominated and what gets put on the list. Given that we're debating all of those other ways, you know, EPH, 3SV, and the other things, I don't think it's appropriate to micromanage the individual nomination lists by removing, four and two and things like this. I think we should just go with whatever the nomination process produces. And if that happens to be, four episodes of some series in 1 year, then that's what the nominators have chosen. And that's what the list should contain.
All right. Now that we've had...
We have a standing on the road.
Yeah. Ms. Neal, for what purpose does the member rise?
No.
No. It was the motion was one speaker for and one speaker against, with no more than 1 minute for each of them. Mr. Kronengold, for what purpose does the member rise?
I move to amend this motion to add a sunrise, 1 year sunrise and 1 year sunset clause. We described earlier this meeting.
Objection.
Objection.
Second. Second.
What is your objection?
Making an amendment is debate. We are out of time.
No.
No. By standing rule, yes. It is not.
Yeah. Mr. Bloom is correct. By standing rule, this amendment is in order. Is there a second?
Yes.
Second.
Is there any...
Undebatable.
It's not debatable.
Debate.
Yes. Thank you. All right. We're going to vote on the amendment to add a sunrise and a sunset clause, thus making it, by definition, delayed ratification. All those in favor, please raise your hands. All right, hands down. All those opposed? Hands down. The noes appear to have it. They do have it. The amendment fails. I'd now like to vote on the underlying motion. I'd really like to do that now. Is there any objection? No. All right. All those in favor of ratifying nominee diversity as amended, raise your hands. All those opposed, the ayes appear to have it. They do have it. The motion is ratified. And I am going to move that we stand in recess for 5 minutes so that we can have a technical timeout and people can use the restroom.